So this video is an overview of inflammation. My suggestion is that you firstly watch this one to get a general idea of what it's all about, and then later watch two other videos I have on acute inflammation and chronic inflammation just to learn more details about inflammation. So an inflammation is the response of vascularized tissue to an offending agent. An offending agent can range from foreign bodies or infections to damaged tissue and many other things that later in the video we go through them. Well, I want you to pay attention to the fact that this only happens in vascularized tissue because we need blood to bring all the cells and mediators involved in inflammation. The goal of inflammation is to remove and eliminate the offending agent. So inflammation features have been recognized and known to people for thousands of years. They have even been described in Egyptian papyrus dating back to around 3,000 years before Christ. In inflammation, we have two fives. Firstly, the five cardinal signs, and then the five R's, which are the steps of inflammation because they all start with an R. So let's go through them. So the first fives are the cardinal signs, which describe what an inflammation looks like. The first four of them are pretty easy, and I'm sure we have all seen them. They have been described by Romans for like as early as 2,000 years ago. They are redness, swelling, heat, and pain, or in Latin, rubor, tumor, calor, and dolor. The fifth one was added in the 19th century, and it's loss of function, or functio laesa in Latin. But what causes an inflammatory response? An inflammation can be caused by a variety of different agents, mostly falling under the following four categories. Firstly, infections, of course. The second one would be tissue necrosis, meaning necrotic cells. So it's important to know that necrosis causes inflammation because it releases the dead cellular content into the extracellular area. So to learn more about this, you can check my video on necrosis. The third one would be foreign bodies, for example, urate crystals in gout disease, or cholesterol crystals in atherosclerosis, or for example, lipids in obesity-associated metabolic syndrome. The fourth one would be immune reactions or hypersensitivity reactions. So that can be triggered by self-antigens, for example, in case of autoimmune diseases, or for example, environmental substances in allergies. Next, let's move on to the steps of an inflammatory response and see what actually happens during an inflammation. The steps of inflammatory response are also referred to as five R's, as I mentioned earlier. First one would be recognition of the injurious agent. The second one would be recruitment of leukocytes. The third one would be removal of the agent. Number four is regulation or control of the response. And number five is resolution or repair. But let's learn more about them a little bit more. Let's get into details of these steps. So firstly, during the first step, the offender has to be recognized. So this responsibility falls on macrophages, dendritic cells, and mast cells. If you want to learn more about these cells of the immune system, you can watch my video on that. Then the second step follows. Once these cells recognize the presence of an offender, for example, a necrotic tissue, microbes, or a foreign agent, they just secrete mediators of inflammation. These mediators can be amines like histamine or cytokines like interleukin 1. If you want to learn more about mediators of inflammation, you can watch my video on that. After having been released locally, mediators of inflammation promote a number of things. So firstly, dilation of small vessels. Secondly, increased permeability of the microvasculature, allowing plasma proteins and leukocytes to leave the circulation. And the third one would be recruitment of leukocytes and later their immigration from the circulation to the site of injury. So here we have a normal arteriole And then we have an arterial in case of inflammation. So please note how it's got dilated and note the distance between each endothelial cell. So the permeability has been increased. Increased permeability and interendothelial space results in fluid and protein leakage from the vasculature. So after having exited the vessel, this fluid, which is high in protein content and cellular debris, would be called an exudate. Exudate is what causes edema or swelling in inflammation, what we learned about in the cardinal signs. So here, please note the difference between exudate and transudate. So exudate is high in protein content and exits the vessels in case of inflammation. Transudate, on the other hand, is a fluid with low protein content and a little or no cellular debris at all. It exits the vessel as a result of an imbalance of hydrostatic or osmotic pressure. So the exit of transudate from the blood happens in the case of liver or kidney disease, in which we have, for example, too little protein production in the liver or too much protein secretion via the kidney, resulting in too little protein content in the blood and therefore causing osmotic imbalance. A transudate is practically a filtrate of blood exiting the vessel to bring the vessel and its surrounding to osmotic balance. But then it's completely irrelevant to inflammation, so I'm going to erase it. Following the increased endothelial permeability, the leukocytes cross the vessel and arrive to the site of focus of inflammation. These leukocytes are mainly phagocytic, like macrophages who eat up and just digest the offender. Or they can also be granulocytes to release granules full of potent chemicals. This results in the elimination of microbes or dead cells or whatever other offending agent that we have there, and therefore completing that third step. So far, the recognition of the injurious agent has been completed, the leukocytes have been recruited to the site of the inflammation, and the offending agent has been removed and eliminated. The next step is the regulation and termination of the response. Inflammatory response, if not regulated, can have harmful consequences and damage the tissue in the process of removing the offending agent. Most cells involved in inflammation have short half-lives and die by apoptosis within a few hours. The same goes for the mediators, which have short half-lives and decay quickly. There are also a number of signals that actively downregulate the inflammatory response. This happens mostly by a switch in the concentration of mediators from pro-inflammatory leukotrienes to anti-inflammatory lipoxins. So by this point, the regulation step is also completed. But what is the outcome of the initial inflammation? There are three major possibilities. First one is the perfect outcome, which is the complete resolution, leaving no mark behind, which is the case when the offense is not too extensive. The next possibility is healing by leaving a scar tissue or connective tissue behind. So this would involve production of cytokines and growth factors, recruiting fibroblasts to produce extracellular matrix proteins and cells. Another possibility would be the progression of the acute inflammation into a chronic inflammation. So this happens in the case of persistent injurious agent or interference with the healing process. And that concludes the five steps or the five R's of inflammation and brings us to different types of inflammation. So far, it's been made clear, I think, that we have two different types of inflammation. Firstly, acute inflammation, which is the initial rapid response to the injurious agents and lasts for minutes or hours, so it only has like a short duration. So it's also important to know that neutrophils are the major leukocytes involved in it. The second one would be chronic inflammation, which happens if the acute inflammation doesn't achieve its goal of eliminating the offender and instead progresses into a long-lasting chronic inflammation. Inflammation can also be categorized based on its location, so it can be local or systemic. Local inflammations happen in response to a local infection or injurious agent, despite the fact that most of the response is limited to the local site of injury. Local inflammation can also have systemic manifestations. So just think of fever in the case of a bacterial or viral pharyngitis. In rare cases, for example, disseminated bacterial infections, we would have systemic inflammatory reaction. This reaction is called sepsis. Thank you very much for watching this video. Don't forget to subscribe to the channel. If you want, you can also find us on Facebook and Instagram. Don't forget to take a look at signups.org.